Hundreds of job opportunities are available at the First Philippine Industrial Park. That's a special economic zone established by First Philippine Holdings and partner Sumitomo Corporation of Japan. Now, the 520-hectare ecozone is home to over 100 locators and has become a key source of employment for nearly 80,000 Filipinos.
Let's learn more about the investment environment and job opportunities at the FPIP. We are joined by Ricky Carandang, its Vice President and External Affairs Head. Both FPIP and this news channel are part of the Lopez Group of Companies. Ricky, welcome to the show. I hear that you're looking for a lot of people. And please don't take Ron. I won't survive this job without him. So, you've been announcing earlier this year that there are a lot of jobs in FPIP, right? And again, this announcement, and you have a job fair. Is it very hard these days to find the right people to fill up those job opportunities?
Well, it's not very hard. I mean, there are a lot of jobs available in the park and in other industrial parks. One challenge which might sound familiar to you is this, that while there are a lot of people who are looking for employment, there are certain types of jobs that require certain specific skills. And as you all know, there's somewhat of a job and skills mismatch. So that's a challenge that we try to deal with when we are trying to look for people to work in the park. So one of the services FPIP provides is it tries to help our locators find people with employable skills. And that has evolved over the last few years because whereas in the beginning, people would go for, I mean, the jobs would be very simple, blue collar jobs, welders, crane operators, and things like that. Now the job demand is evolving. As we get locators that are more sophisticated in their manufacturing, we're seeing that there's a demand for more engineers, for example, in the park. So the job market in FPIP is evolving into sort of more higher end types of employment opportunities.
Go ahead, Ricky. No, I was going to ask, and to solve that, are you partnering with any establishments, most especially schools, training centers, to properly look for those people to get that match for the job and the skills?
Well, yes, we are working on closing that gap. First of all, we have First Philippine Holdings has set up First College, which is a school that teaches students the skills that are required for them to get jobs in the industrial park. It's really a feeder school for the industrial park. So we know what kind of jobs they're looking for. We know what kind of jobs are available. And we're trying to create an atmosphere where people can go to this school and learn the skills that can employ them in those opportunities. We're also partnering with educational institutions around Santo Tomas and Tanawan in Batangas, where we're located. And we're doing our best really to try to get people from the local community. So Tanawan and Santo Tomas have hosted us for over 25 years, and we're happy to provide employment for them. And we do prefer to hire people from those local communities. So we're working with the LGU, we're working with our own sort of business opportunities, and we're working with the locators to try to close that gap between the skills and the jobs available.
I hear you even have Dyson with this 11 billion facility in your park, and it's expanding. Everybody seems to be expanding, Ricky. What are the kinds of companies that you have there who are looking for all of these engineers and other high value jobs?
Well, we're very lucky and very happy to have companies like Dyson. And you know, that's a cutting edge consumer electronics company. We're happy to have them. They're looking for engineers. We have a wide array of industries represented, from consumers to aerospace to electronics and other components. And they're going higher up the value chain. So while they still have need for workers in the sort of blue collar type of work, increasingly we're seeing a demand for engineers, as I said, and people with higher skill sets.
And with your expansion, are you still also looking for locators there? Are you looking at new industries, inviting companies from new industries and sectors in the coming years?
We're always looking for locators, and you know, if you talk to the BOI and PEZA, these are the government offices that are in charge of attracting investments. There's a lot of opportunity for us to be able to try to grab. As you all know, the transport industry is evolving from using internal combustion engines to electric cars, right?
Yeah.
And that is a huge growing market. The country, the government is trying to attract investments in e-vehicles, not just assembly, but the components of that, such as batteries and things like that. So we are actually working with government to try to attract these kinds of industries to the country. We've always been interested in aerospace. We have a large aerospace company that's one of our key locators in FPIP. And we're hoping that that industry grows, as it grows, we're hoping that they locate in FPIP, which, if I may say so, is pretty strategically located.
Right. I was going to ask that as well. When you're enticing and encouraging new locators to FPIP, what are the main selling points that you tell them in comparison to other industrial parks in the Ikala Barzon area?
Well, first of all, let me say that all the industrial parks, we all work together to try to bring investments into the country. Okay. But within that context, obviously, we compete with each other. And I like to think that FPIP, in terms of the way it's managed, the way the infrastructure is built, very robust infrastructure that we have that can withstand sort of natural calamities like storms and all that. So we've really made it a point to have a robust, resilient infrastructure. We're also very conscious about our carbon footprint and our impact on the environment. So we take great efforts to manage the use of resources like energy and water. And as you know, as consumers become more conscious about climate change and its effects, they also are demanding from companies that they buy products from that they be made the products be made in more sustainable and environment friendly ways. And FPIP, I like to think, is taking the lead in creating an atmosphere where locators can come and they can be sure that the resources that they use are managed properly and in the most sustainable way possible.
It seems, Ricky, you have a huge backyard. Such a huge playground. So, and I think there's a news article I read that you are even expanding this 500 hectare area, 200 more hectares in a township, and EV, I think you have a project with IFC and First Balfour for electric vehicles.
Well, there is an effort to study whether or not electric vehicles can be introduced into the public transport systems of certain LGUs. That's a project of First Balfour, and they're doing some of the testing and the experimenting in FPIP in the park. We are looking at using for our fleet. We are eventually looking at making that EV, and we're working on that. But there's a lot of things going on. As you mentioned, there's a township idea. And the idea is, as you attract people who are more white collar, they're not just looking for a place to go to work, right?
Right.
They're looking for lifestyle options. Mm-hmm. So now we get concerns about, so if I'm going to have to work in Batangas, are there places to eat? Are there leisure activities that I can avail of during the week after work?
That's not in Tagaytay.
Yeah. So increasingly, the demands of the workers are becoming more sophisticated. Mm-hmm. And as a result of that, we are also trying to adjust and to try to give them lifestyle options moving forward. So that it's not just, FPIP is not just a place to work.
Mm-hmm.
It's also a place where you can chill after work and enjoy maybe a meal or a drink with your friends.
Yeah. Ricky, all of these things we've been talking about since the start of the show, it seems like good economic tea leaves, you know? It's like a good sign that the economy's gonna grow. Are you happy with what you're seeing? Are there any risks that you would like to talk about moving forward as everybody seems to be waiting for the economy to reopen completely and sustainably?
Well, yes, you know, the pandemic has had some after effects. Supply chains were totally disrupted during the pandemic. And what companies have learned from this is that they cannot put all their eggs in one basket. So, for example, if you're a large multinational manufacturing company, you used to have all of your facilities either in China or Vietnam or Indonesia. And now what they're trying to do is they're trying to spread it out. Mm-hmm. So you may have one component being done in Vietnam, another component being done in the Philippines. So we're working to try to attract more of these companies that are trying to diversify their supply chains. And I see a lot of opportunity there because partly because of the tensions between the US and China, a lot of companies that want to sell products to the United States are trying to diversify their supply chains. And we're hoping that some of that diversity finds itself in the Philippines. Having said that though, there are some challenges. There is a general economic slowdown that we're all experiencing globally, and that has led to more sluggish investment growth. If you take a look at the FDI numbers for the country, they were down about 20% in the first half. So there are external factors that are having a negative impact. Also, I noted in earlier in your newscast that you mentioned that Congress had passed amendments to the PPP Act,
yeah.
And that there is a way, they're trying to make it easier to invest. Remember, no matter how good our investment climate is, we are competing with our neighbors, with Thailand, with Indonesia, with Vietnam. And while I believe we have a better product overall to sell than those other countries, there are certain advantages that they have created in terms of making it easier for investors to come in and set up their manufacturing. So we're always looking at how we compare with other countries. Because when a company is looking at setting up a manufacturing facility, they're not just looking at the Philippines, they're looking at other countries around the region. So we're in competition with our neighbors.
Aside from the plans that you already mentioned, Ricky, are there any other new developments with the FPIP that you're excited about in the coming years?
Well, really the idea that we can create a community that is environmentally sound, that takes care of the environment and the host communities, and that provides options more than just work, right? So retail spaces, residential spaces. We're hoping that eventually FPIP can become almost like a city within the cities of where it's located, and provide a higher standard of living to the communities that host us.
Of all the industries you're seeing in FPIP, which ones are growing the fastest?
Oh, there's many, surprisingly. As I mentioned, EVs are coming in, and that's growing very rapidly around the world. In the Philippines, we're looking at, there's a lot of investments in data centers. Mm-hmm. As our economy becomes more digital and transactions go online, there's much more need for data centers. So the big data center companies are sniffing around in the Philippines, and some have already got a presence here. So things that are tech related are always good. We're seeing interest in defense and as I mentioned, aerospace. So we're hoping also that is something that we're going to see future growth in. We've had a lot of trade missions coming in from other countries. So there is definitely interest there's more interest in looking at the Philippines now than there was a few years ago. It's just that, like everyone else, there are certain macroeconomic conditions globally that are slowing things down. But once the global economy begins to pick up again, I think we're going to see more people coming in and taking a look at the Philippines.
Sorry, I'm just going to jump back to a topic when we were talking about sustainability and environment. I know the FPIP has been always concerned about the environment and its carbon footprint, but I understand you have a plan mapped out for it to be decarbonized and a regenerative park by 2030. Tell us more about it and what's the status of that.
So as you know, the Lopez Group has always been very concerned about the impact that our businesses have on the environment. And an industrial park, you can imagine, has a big carbon footprint, right? But there are certain things that we can do to manage our use of resources better. Can we use cleaner energy, for example? We're trying to move towards using more and more renewable energy in the park, mm-hmm. and we're trying to encourage our locators to do the same. We're managing our water in a way that we know that this is a finite resource and it needs to be managed properly. Mm-hmm. There's no water crisis or anything like mm-hmm. that, but even before we start to feel the scarcity of water resources, we already want to be able to manage it so that we don't have to feel the negative impacts of water scarcity moving forward. So for our locators, it's really the energy and the water that we're trying to manage very well for them, so that they don't have problems with it moving forward in the future.
Thank you so much, Ricky. Always good to talk to you.
Thank you, Mr. Vice President of External Affairs.